Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to our August 1st meeting of the Board of Commissioners. And to start out with, if you'll join me in prayer, please. Almighty Heavenly Father, we come to you today with grateful hearts and thankfulness. Thank you for all you do for us. And Lord God, we just appreciate what you have done for our county and for our country. We are so blessed here, and some days I think we just don't recognize it. Dear God, be with all of our law enforcement as they are out today patrolling, protecting our well-beings. And be with our military abroad that is doing the same. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Public speakers, we have one. Mr. Tony Cox. Got the pledge. Excuse me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Linda's going to sing for us, too, this morning. All right, public comments. Tony?
You know, I'm glad we've got these new security checkpoints in here. However, it appears that not everybody is having to go through those checkpoints. Now, I know that me and the sheriff had to go through that checkpoint this morning, but others didn't. Now, if I can go through that checkpoint, and if our sheriff can go through that checkpoint, why can't everybody go through that checkpoint? However, special people. There's a newspaper article this weekend about a woman suing Walmart, Burlington Police Department, Burlington City Government over a false arrest. But a police officer said, I'm 80% sure, 80%. So in America anymore, if somebody is 80% sure, we just go ahead and put them through the ringer, because in America now, it is better that you are guilty than innocent. The innocent have to prove their guilt, not the people that are accusing the people of something having to prove that they've done something wrong. I was floored. After all these years, I always believed that your Alamance County Planning Board had sworn oath to the Constitution. That just devastated me going back to 2007 after the way those people done sending out their letters for their vigilante groups. Now I see them as a vigilante group. I guess next I'll find out that the county manager doesn't swear an oath to the Constitution. Maybe the county attorney. Boy, it's amazing to me how much I used to believe and think that I have nowadays found out that are wrong. Oh boy. And people talk about the kids and the grandkids and what you're leaving for them and so forth and so on. And to me, our Constitution, that's the big dog right there. But nowadays it don't matter. It's amazing to me. And to see people constantly getting out of prison that didn't do what they were accused of doing. But not even so much as a we're sorry. But hey, the people continue to put those that committed those acts against those innocent people up on pedestals. And they turn other people against the person that was convicted of something that they didn't do. But hey, go America.
All righty. Thank you, Tony. Any responses? Okay, with none heard, ask for approval of the agenda. Everybody okay with it?
I move.
Second.
All right, thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, consent agenda. Are there any items that you would like to pull on this?
So moved.
So moved. Okay, thank you, David. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. None being heard. All right, first thing we have on our docket today is public hearing from Matt Williams. Yes, sir. Welcome, Matt.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm delighted to be here this morning to introduce an economic development project for CS Carolina. They are a local business that is expanding again. We have two gentlemen that represent the company management with us this morning, June Kang and IT Ju. Mr. Kang is going to come and talk about the project and the company, answer any questions you might have, the public might have, and then hopefully we can move forward with that. So with that, I'm going to ask Mr. Kang to come up and represent him, and welcome. Glad to have you here this morning.
Thanks so much.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's my honor to be here and to make a presentation. It is an exciting time, even though it's right now it's we experienced very slow second half of this year. We are very much committed to go forward and think forward. So, without further ado, let's go over the presentation to talk about who we are, what we plan to do, and what it means to the city of the county of Alamance. So, all right. What the meeting? Okay. Okay, I think it'll coming up. It's coming up.
Okay.
I can just give you a verbal presentation. Basically, we are CS Carolina. We make synthetic polyester filament yarn, and we are texturizing it. So here in Burlington. We are a part of CS Group that is in Korea, in worldwide we have over 500 employees. Here in the city of Burlington, we have about 57 people working for us as of July 31st this year. We have a capacity of 14.4 million pound per year. That's a lot of yarn, by the way. And we have a revenue of about $23.2 million. It's an aggregate figure for North America. All right. So what we plan to do is to make an upstream expansion. We are bring a lot of the raw material from overseas, mainly from Asia, a lot of Chinese imports, a lot of Taiwanese imports, which we depend on to make the synthetic yarn. But what we plan to do is to make upstream expansion so that we make that the raw material that we're using here locally. That means more investment into the county and the more jobs here in the local community. We are bringing the latest technology. We plan to bring the latest technology from Germany and to incorporate very versatile operations. During this process, we are going to make $9.8 million of new taxable investment. So it will definitely bring in more revenue to the local counties and the city. Also, we are creating about 42 jobs with this expansion. We are making new construction. So we are working with a local contractor to make the buildings. And now besides the building itself, we'll purchase a lot of local products and services such as electricity, utilities, test equipment, production supplies, packing materials, and so on and so forth. The jobs we are creating, the 42 new jobs, will have an average figure of $36,738 average annual salary, which is higher than the county average salary. And I think we also empower with the state's effort to attract more manufacturing to the state, so which will help to create more jobs. And this is our just first step for the future expansion. And with the success with the expansion, we'll continue to expand and create more jobs to the county. So that's going to be it.
Sounds good.
All right.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
What's the practical application of your product? What do you do with this product?
Special the garments that we are wearing, like when you go out to play golf, it's a very heat observing or cooling of the fabric. So it goes a lot into the sports garments. Also, it goes into the industrial applications, into automobiles. So we actually, one of our major customers that we have, make the fabric for the headliners or the seat covers in the GM Malibu car. So
do you have a contract with GM for that already?
We're not the first supplier, but we are supplying our current yarn goes into the Malibu program.
Okay.
Right now. Yes, right. Sir.
I had a couple of questions about the agreement. The agreement talks about in phase one that you got from the county, the incentive support package.
Yes, sir.
In 2014, it talked about $6.2 million. I think that was in the whereas statement. But it looks like when I read down further that maybe it was $6.5 million.
Mm-hmm.
Was it a $6.5 million or $6.2?
The minimum I see was $6.5. So we are the timeline to get to 6.5 million is by the end of this year, so we are still working on it. We are in course right now, and there's two parts in that agreement, which is the new tax reinvestments, and the other part was creating jobs,
right.
And we are ahead of job creation.
Right.
And we made about a little more than $5 million so far, so we are still working on that $1.5 million more investment. Right. Before the end of this year. Yes, sir.
All right. So then, yeah, go ahead.
Well, and then there was, with the phase one, there's going to be 22 new jobs.
Correct.
And phase two, there's going to be 42
yes,
new
sir.
Jobs. So together that adds up to 64. But there's language in this agreement that speaks about 100 jobs. And I was a little confused by that.
What we were trying to do, and we can go back and check the job numbers, is these, regardless of phase one, I think we're at 57 jobs. These will be 42
on top of the 57.
Right. So the original agreement was for 22 jobs.
So they're ahead of that.
Way ahead. Right. So we were not giving them credit for those jobs that they created in phase one, but it will be additional from this point moving forward for the 42 new jobs.
Thanks so much for that.
All right, thank you.
42 more.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So move.
I'll second it.
All right, we got a first and a second.
Yeah, to approve the package.
We got to have a public hearing first. So.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
But I do want to say, I want to thank Ms. Coop for the work, and we had some issues making sure our numbers were right, and we really appreciate you work with our tax department and also with MAC, so we want to thank you for what you've done to get us to this point. So we thank you.
Thanks so much.
All right, well, no more commissioner comments.
And I would just like to ask that before we actually sign the agreement, if it's approved after the public hearing, that we correct any of the inconsistencies
right.
within the agreement.
The numbers.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes,
very
sir.
Good.
All right.
So we will open it up now. Thank you. We'll open it up for public hearing. Start on the left-hand side over here. Would anyone like to speak towards this? Right-hand side.
Seems like we have a history with confusing stuff with these contracts, and these contracts are really, really, really important. And very close attention has got to be made on these contracts. Very close. These are things that are binding, that there should not be any confusion, but there's confusion.
Any other comments? All right, with that, take a motion to go out of public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, now we'll open it up for a motion to approve.
Motion.
Motion to approve. Thank you, David.
Second.
Thank you, Linda. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any in opposition? Been hearing none. Thank you very much, and
let
welcome.
Let me say something.
Yes,
I've been here for 20 years, and we've had all of these companies coming in, and I just hope the next 20 years we keep having them coming in. We've never lost a dollar.
I know.
In any of our incentives, and all of the companies that we have approved have been outstanding companies, and they continue to be, and we expect to hopefully next year, Mike will bring more of them in here.
Mm-hmm.
In the year after.
And you know what, Mr. Smith, the good thing about that, we're not like Winston-Salem. We have terms that help us out if we get in a bind with them. The clawbacks is what fixes that. So thanks to management for working with that, and Clyde and all that do that. All right, very good. Thank you very much. Next, we have Mac back again. So keep it on the roll, Mac.
Well, ask and I'll deliver, right?
There you go.
I'm also here to introduce another exciting project. CS Carolina is an existing company expanding. Prescient is a potential new location of a new company to Alamance County. We're very excited about this particular opportunity, in that it would mean a lot of new jobs with good salaries. It would mean a brand new building to the county tax base, and so we're very excited about this opportunity. And with us this morning, and he took the red eye from California to get here this morning. So if he doesn't fall asleep at the podium, he will have already had a successful morning.
Yeah.
We have the vice president of the company is here, and he'll introduce himself. And also we have the consultant that the company is working with on their site selection, whom I know, and we worked with her on a couple of different occasions. She is also here. But I'll invite up Greg Paciana, who is the vice president for Prescient, to come and talk about the company and who they are, what they do, and answer any questions you or the public may have about this particular project. So Greg, if you want to come on up. It's a pleasure to have you here in Alamance County this morning. And we had a strong cup of coffee across the street in the morning.
Guaranteed to keep you awake.
Yeah, I think I'm in good shape. Well, thank you for giving us the opportunity to come and see you all here. I actually live up the road in Hillsboro, so it's not a long commute, just away with the family before school starts.
Right.
So got back in time. I'm new with Prescient. Been with them about 2 months right now. Prescient is a company. It's a light gauge steel building is what they ultimately make, basically the infrastructure, the superstructure of a building. They're fully integrated. They've got an architectural and engineering design team. They manufacture the steel, light gauge steel themselves, and then they've got installation crews. They're currently based out of Arvada, which is in Denver. They've been in business since 2009, but really, truly since 2013 when they first were funded. They'll do about 3 million square feet of construction this year, of actual production.
Wow.
of these buildings. To give you a real short, so they have a software system that basically plugs in with their architectural software, so they basically standardize building designs so they can turn around a design of a building in a very, very short period of time. It's cost competitive with wood. Generally with wood you can only go up at about 4 or 5 stories. This allows them to go up 12 stories. So it really changes some of the dynamics, particularly when you're looking at hotels, multifamily housing, and student housing. So in a nutshell, what they're basically able to do is to basically work with contractors and provide a light gauge steel building in a very short period of time, competitive with wood pricing, much cheaper than concrete. So really kind of a game changer. So the plan is here is hopefully as soon as possible to try and get a facility here. We had looked around the East Coast, Georgia area, Virginia area. I'm here, so I can't tell you that I'm neutral. We're happy with the potential agreement that's in front of us right now. Timing is critical for us right now. We've got an order book on the East Coast that's going to need to be supplied. So we're looking at about north of 200 jobs. The majority of those will be coming over the next year. And it's skilled from welders, quality control people. So what's also a big part of this is working with some of the local community colleges too to make sure we can get the staff in place. That's our big issue. That's my first office when I was in the construction business was actually on Clay Street in Mevin. So it's good to be back in locally.
Good.
I don't know if there's any other specific questions. I think just looking at my notes, the total expenditures between the buildings and equipment, we're looking at about a $19 million investment right off the bat. That's where we are. And if there's any questions, I'd love to answer. Thank you.
So I have one more inconsistency that I saw. It's not material, Tony, but just it looks like with all this is going to be joint support from the right. County and the city of Graham and the city of Mevin, and all three of us together would be providing $1.165 million.
Yes, sir.
But when I add up the individual contributions from all the parties, it all adds up to $1,065,000. So it's like a
$100,000 difference.
Yeah, $100,000 difference.
I think part of that is because the 1.065 is the cash incentive that's being shared, and there's another 100 in fees that I think are that the city right. Mevin
that are being waived.
Impact fees.
All right. Thank you for that clarification.
That's right. Yep. So total is 1.165, but that's part of that being
the 1.1 is the total.
Yeah.
And if I could say this is located at North Carolina Commerce Park, and one of the reasons, you know, this is a joint project between the county and Mevin and Graham. One of the reasons, and we appreciate Samet being here as well, one of the reasons this is very exciting to us is this is manufacturing, and it really will give some legitimacy to the park. I think we've heard some of the residents say, well, you got lucky with Walmart, you got lucky with Lidl. This having three major companies within the North Carolina Commerce Park within a three-year time frame is really, really huge. And also, if you look at the 205 jobs that they're looking at, it's manufacturing jobs. And the average salary is $46,650, I believe, or it's around that.
Linda says she wants a job.
So it really is the type of job that we're looking for. They were originally saying $18 million in investment, and our cash grant is based upon 15.3 million. So that was a number they were sure about as far as the taxable, but we expect them to spend much more than that within Alamance County and for this project.
Yeah.
Well, and being in construction, you see a lot of the metal building taking over a lot of sticks and bricks and that type thing, and it's the future of our country, I think. So,
sounds like they may be able to help us with our
animals. I was just thinking we might have a drawing coming there very soon. All right, any more questions, anybody?
Okay. Do you think you'll have a trouble with skill base staffing?
That's my one concern, frankly, because I've got to kind of where the rubber meets the road here. It's my responsibility. It's going to take some training. We're going to plan. We've got a pretty good budget set up, but we want to bring some people to Denver, hopefully try and train some people there at the end of this year. and then bring them on.
How long has the company been operating in Denver?
2013.
So they got 3 years under the belt there.
And they've actually just into a new facility there. They upsized also.
Okay. Have you contacted Alamance Community College to help in any of your training?
We're getting helped out there.
Well, so. I think we have the people to fill those jobs.
Could I ask, what attracted you to Alamance County?
I'm a little biased. I think part of the workforce also got some other private business owners that have done well here, the Eurosport guys in Mebane, who kind of made the jump from really, I think they were in Durham and then Orange and whatnot. Arca, another company over there too that's had good success. So that kind of spoke for itself. To be candid, Atlanta was attractive in a lot of ways because the incentives are pretty strong there, and the airport for what we do was kind of important. But I think also the education level in the area, and hopefully we think to be able to get the skilled labor and training with the schools is important to us. But from also a transportation standpoint, it's a good location too. So.
But the incentives were important.
Yeah.
And so I'm hearing education being important.
All right. Very good. All right, no more questions, and we will take a motion for opening the public hearing. Thank you, sir.
I'll move that we open for the public hearing.
All right.
Thank
you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Once again, this time we'll start over here. We're going to go backwards.
Okay. I don't think I've ever stood at this podium and ever said no about new jobs. I've always been in favor of new jobs, period. Period. So an implication of something like that is not me. Going back to the Taj Mahal house, I told you at the first meeting over there at Family Justice Center that I thought metal buildings was a superb alternative with a huge difference in price. Hey, I'm for jobs, all about jobs. So, hey. We did hear about during the budget, though, $100,000 being given to that company over there that you personally attacked and said you were offended by it.
The offer on.
Okay.
What?
we'll figure that out later. Anybody else? Hey, Brian. How are you?
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Brian Hall from Samet. Thanks for the opportunity. This is a great project. To support what Craig had to say, our investments in the Commerce Park, the work that we've started many years ago that we're continuing to do with Mac's office, this project, this opportunity is validation of all this investment, all this time, all this energy that collectively as a team we all have put in place. So appreciate your support.
Thank you. All right.
And again, I do want to thank Mac and Mebane and Graham, because without that collaboration, we would not be here.
That is,
and we would not be in the North Carolina Commerce.
Well
Park.
Said. Yes, sir. All right. With that, do I hear a motion to go out of public hearing?
So moved.
All right.
Second.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. And now we will hear a motion for the incentive.
So moved.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye. Uh-huh.
All right. All in agreement here. Huh?
Yep.
Thank you very much,
Matt.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Good luck, man.
Okay. Good luck. Good things happening here, right? Yeah. That's good.
Sounds good.
Mm-hmm. All right. There he is. You were over here a minute ago. Jeremy, please come forward.
I usually have a hard time hiding.
I was saying, maybe you didn't have your coat on earlier. I just was looking for a white shirt.
I try it, but they always spot me.
How are you doing this morning?
Good.
Thank you so much for having me here to talk with you about taxes. I know it's the most exciting topic in the world. But, you know, it kind of is to me. I'm very happy about the work that has been performed by our team in our collections area, and happy to get to relate that to you. I should have a slide up there, and I'll see if I can remember how to use the clicker here. This is the annual settlement of 2015-2016 taxes. Each year we give this report so we can see how our program is working and make refinements as we need to make refinements. So now this year, for total 2015 levy, there was $68,548,334.35, and that was the general fund only. Out of that, we collected $67,617,787.01, $930,547.34 remains uncollected. That gives us a rate of 98.64, and that is something that I'm very happy about. Matter of fact, I've talked to a few outside collections agencies off and on over the years, and a lot of times I'll tell them what our percentages are on our collections, and they generally tell me to have a nice day, you know. Let me know if they're needed. That's a strong collection rate. When you compare it to the past 5 years, as you can see, we've been having strong growth really starting around 2012. Each year it's been climbing. This year is a 0.32% increase off of our last year, so I feel really good about that. Our five-year average, 97.54%, we're up over that five-year average, so certainly we're showing improvement. I also have shown it with the registered motor vehicles taken out, because the previous number, there is a change halfway through when the DMV takes over the registered motor vehicles, which is advantageous to us on our collection rate. So to factor that out, you can see the increase is still there. It's a little more mild, but if you look at the percent of increase with that factored out, we've been picking up speed from virtually no increase to a stronger one, to a stronger one, and hopefully we'll continue just to pick up some steam here. The five-year average, excluding registered motor vehicles, is 98.16%, again, versus our 98.64%. Another important comparison is to similar counties. Now, we've looked at population statistics, the valuations in the counties, the household incomes, the size of the counties, the location of the counties, to try to pull out the statistically most similar five. In order, there they are: Davidson, Rowan, Pitt, Catawba, and Johnston. As you can see, their average collection rate is 97.99. Now, this is their most recently confirmed DOR certified rate. This means this is their last year's rate. When you get rates this year, they're putting their presentations together like we are, and everything's in flux. Sometimes you have some surprises. So we like to work off the certified numbers. So this is their previous year's rate. But again, compared to that 98.64, I think we're doing pretty well. You'll see that Johnston County at 98.8 and Pitt County at 98.81 were out in front. Actually, the most similar county, Davidson County, is at 96.88. And so we feel that our performance is pretty good when compared to our peers. And again, these numbers exclude the registered motor vehicles, just to not muddy the water with that change that's occurred. So if you look at the amount of money we've brought in, again, this is general fund, you can see that there's been a trend of increase every year. Now, there's one standout year here where it decreased, but that is the effect of the motor vehicles coming off of my rolls and onto the state rolls. If you factor those back in, it has been increased each year. Of course, this year we've brought in more, we've had more levy collected than we have in any previous period. The same is to study uncollected tax. You can see there's a trend here where that's been slowly rising and has now turned. On percentage, that's pretty flat. It's rising because the tax base is rising, the collected rises, the uncollected rises, but the proportions are the same. Until this year, we're actually several percent ahead, so even though we've had a rising tide, our uncollected is down. So we feel pretty good about that. A few things I want to mention, just an outlook for the future. We are now collecting Mebane taxes. I'm very excited about that. The citizens of Mebane no longer receive two bills. They receive just one bill. We handle that ourselves. And we're very excited about the utility to the citizen and the efficiencies that we're realizing by bringing that under one roof. So definitely very excited. I also want to mention, you know, next year is reval. I never forget. That's on my mind every day, as you might imagine. There are some challenges to the collector side when you're doing a revaluation. Some of it comes just from the strain on the system generally. It will put a strain on resources. The other thing is when you're fielding appeals, while someone's under appeal, you're not enforcing collections on them.
Right.
So when you bring in a lot of appeals, which I guarantee you will have, hopefully not half as many as last time, but thousands of appeals are thousands of appeals, that slows the collector down because they have to compare notes and make sure that they're not enforcing on someone who's under appeal. But we're working to get our efficiencies up. You might have noticed when you received your bill this year that there's a coupon page included in there. We're trying to encourage folks not to put it off for one day, but go ahead and start making payments on it today. We're trying to get bills out a little bit earlier this year than we have in years past, just a little bit, and work with our efficiencies knowing we have this challenge ahead. We don't want to lose ground. And I did want to give you an update. Last year we added an additional position of a delinquent collector and lets you know what how your money is working for you, basically. So the salary infringed to bring on the delinquent collector was about $42,500. Now, our collection fees went up $38,500. This is the fee that we charge to do our collection work to the person being collected. That money is not taken from our taxpaying citizens or taken from the non-taxpaying citizen. That's almost entirely covered the cost of having the delinquent collector, but additionally the increase in our collection rate comes out to about $220,000 of revenue that I believe that collector has generated. So combined they brought in $258,500 of revenue at a cost to us of $42,500. That's a six-fold return. I just wanted to point that out. Sometimes it's easy to see the costs and say, well, why are we spending up this money on additional staff? But I think that this illustrates that we actually have brought more revenue in. And the good thing about that is where the revenue comes from. This is not revenue based on a tax increase on our citizens. This is getting citizens who have not been paying their taxes to pay their taxes. So definitely feel good about that. I want to thank this board for supporting us. There may be a time in the future where I'll raise my hand again, but know that when I ask for additional staff, it's because I think there's a return on investment. I think that it's a wise investment. Are there any questions about the annual settlement?
Well, I do about that job there. Is that a permanent position you're talking about?
Yes.
In the future kind of thing, have you considered hiring a contracted person for 6 months or whatever, that's not a permanent employee to do that job?
You could. There's some challenges. One of the challenges is there isn't an on-season and an off-season.
Mm-hmm.
The season is perpetual. Now, the on-season for the current year begins at delinquency in January and runs through June 30th. But the on-season for the back years picks up in July 1st and runs through December. So half the year, we're trying to catch the fresh money coming in the door before it gets stale, before it gets hard to collect. But the rest of the year, we're digging back on those back years, trying to collect those. So it is a year-round position. The other side is that we entrust these people with Social Security numbers, with bank account numbers. We do go into bank accounts. We do take wages. We do seize property. We collect all the information possible about somebody. I feel more comfortable having somebody that I vetted, I know, I control, than someone coming and going out of the office.
I understand.
All right.
Well, now, additional to the settlement, each year there is a write-off of 10-year-old taxes. The statutes stop our enforcement powers after 10 years. And if we haven't collected it in 10 years and suddenly we lose the ability to use statutory remedies, the odds of us bringing that money in is virtually zero. And we go ahead and write that off. So the 2006 tax year will become uncollectible to us as of September 1st of this year. So the write-off isn't as of today, but as of September 1st when our enforcement powers expire. Now, at closing on June 30th, we had $100,710.14 still outstanding. So after 10 years of work, that was the portion that we simply could not bring in.
What was the total?
$100,710.14, which is a 90, let me give you the right rate. We have a 99.83% collection for that year. The problem with the older years is you do have the motor vehicles still mixed in, and unlike real property, a car can drive away from you. So we have some things that truly become unenforceable. Also, this predates our agreement with the Register of Deeds office, which has been very successful. You can't transfer property without paying the taxes. Yeah. At this time, you could, and we got some murky property situations that made it unenforceable to us. So in the future, that number should diminish as motor vehicles wash out and as that takes effect. But I do need a resolution by the board to write off that amount of money as of September 1st of this year.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor of that?
Aye.
All right. Very good, Chairman.
The final thing I have to present is the order of tax collection, which is each year the tax collector is charged with collecting for the upcoming year. My most recent charge was for the 2015 taxes we just settled, and I do need to be charged for the 2016 taxes to go forward and collect and eventually enforce those as needed.
So moved.
Second. Thank you, Rob.
Thanks.
All in favor?
Uh-huh.
All right, move on.
Jeremy, when can people start expecting bills?
They're out. I got mine last week.
Mine's already paid.
Go Bob.
You haven't deposited my check yet, though.
I'm going to work on that. All right, thank you so much.
Thanks. All right, next we have the Tourism Development Authority, and who's reporting on this?
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure to be here and an honor, and I thank you in advance for your time. My name is Wes Collins. I'm the, the assistant vice chair of the Tourism Development Authority of Alamance County, incoming chairman. Just to give you guys, I think you all have the agreement, the reason I'm here in front of you, but just to give you a little background on the Tourism Development Authority, it is the agency that collects the tax dollars, occupancy tax dollars, from all the hotels in Alamance County. Two-thirds of that actually goes to fund the Convention and Visitors Bureau, which is sole responsibility is to promote tourism in Alamance County as a whole. Not just Burlington, but Alamance County as a whole. The TDA, Tourism Development Authority, is an all-volunteer board. Which presents its own problems in running the Convention and Visitors Bureau. The Convention and Visitors Bureau has stood alone as a separate entity governing itself through the TDA, but actually running itself for about 18 months. Used to be under with MAC over at the Chamber. Hopefully you all know that we've moved the Convention and Visitors Bureau down to the Depot, which is a fantastic location. It's definitely raised foot traffic through the door, raised awareness. They've done a lot of good things down there and will continue to do so. The reason I'm coming here before you today, like I say, with the TDA, it's an all-volunteer board. That presents its own problems with the day-to-day operations of the CVB. What we propose through the interlocal agreement is that the CVB itself will be under the county. We worked with Craig, Susan, Clyde. A lot of people have looked at this, that the board has voted to go in this direction. What this will do is free up the board and the CVB to actually focus on what it needs to focus on, which is bringing dollars, people, additional tourism into Alamance County. The county does a phenomenal job, obviously, in actually administering and running itself, and will do so with the CVB. The board will then be freed up to look for more opportunities, and instead of doing the day by day, week by week, all the nuts and bolts of actually running the CVB, policies, procedures, payrolls, all that, we can actually focus on new projects and doing the CVB justice by directing them in areas that they can actually bring in more tourism dollars. So it just makes sense. In the past 18 months, the board has had some eye-opening experiences with the actual running of the CVB. It just makes sense for somebody who knows exactly what they're doing and does it extremely well to do it and free up the board and free up the CVB. So that's kind of the proposal that we're looking at now. I'll open it up to any questions that you guys may have.
Mr. Chairman, if I could say, and I appreciate Wes for being here and also Brian, and this is really not going to change their operation and how they operate. Really what it's going to do is bring it into the county so that we have more of that day-to-day oversight, which the volunteer board, which is constantly changing, doesn't have. So the thought process right now is that it would be a direct report to the recreation director. So it will, you know, kind of fits there now. So as far as promoting our parks, and so we appreciate Brian Baker and his willingness and his staff to stand up and to take that on as a project and as a department. But we really do appreciate Wes and his board as well for willing to work with us as we have an opportunity for some change and moving forward and really which will be a great direction.
Okay. Would you say this would be, well, let me ask, the employees of CVB would be county employees?
Correct.
And so would this kind of be similar to the relationship, say, with the health department or DSS? Each of those entities has their own board. So in this case, CVB is still under the board of the TDA?
The employees would still be a direct report to REC. And it'd be a direct report to the program manager, the CVB director.
Okay.
But also that person would then report to Brian. So it is a little bit different. The board will do is more policy oriented and looking at how we need to spend money. And positive thing about this as well, that this is not any additional cost to what we're already outlaying. This is strictly paid for through the occupancy tax. So. Yes, we're adding on three new employees, but it is not as far as a direct cost allocation to the county. It's money that was going, we were giving them as far as an allocation monthly anyway.
The occupancy tax takes care of all of that.
It's kind of an enterprise right. To itself.
And I notice that if either board gets dissatisfied, we can terminate in 180 days.
We can go from there. Yes, sir.
Well, it makes sense. I mean, we have the structures in place, the employment function and all that.
And we've had, the board has had conversations with the employees. They're fully aware and they're appreciating the opportunity also to be county employees.
Yeah. All right. With that, any more questions? Can I hear a motion for the resolution to move to that?
I move we approve the resolution.
All right. Second. Thank you, Roger. All in favor? Uh-huh. All right. Very good. All right.
It's really an agreement that
an
I
would agreement.
The
emotion yeah, of resolution. Yeah. Yeah.
Good morning.
Well, hey, good morning.
Where's that bookmobile?
We're working on it. I've had so many positive remarks about that since that got approved. So good. People are, yeah, I get that.
It's
are
exciting.
We there yet? Are we there yet? I have before you a chance for an LSTA grant. An LSTA is Library Services and Technology Act grant, and it's funded through federal funds from International Museum and Library Services Act, so it trickles down, and it's awarded by the state library, and this is complete. There's no matching part to this grant. It's for $32,142, and it's for the library to finally be able to do a long-term planning process, which we never have done. And as we and the county are looking at strategic planning. So the library has also been looking at this for the past 5 or 6 years and sort of figuring out what is our role in the community, what are the community needs, how do I best serve that community. I know all of you probably get asked, our library is going to go away because of e-books. This, by having a strategic plan, it guarantees that we are maintaining our relevance and understanding the needs of our community so that we are meeting those needs.
So moved.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Budget amendment for our sheriff.
I'm opposed.
So moved.
Did I second that?
That was quick, Sheriff. I'm sorry. He tried to help.
Like Rodney Dangerfield, I get no respect.
I'm appearing before you this morning, Commissioner, to ask that we be allowed to move $32,150 from federal drug asset seizure monies into a line item so we can purchase 6 walkie-talkies that will be inscripted. Our drug people are trying to work on drug deals, and the drug dealers have more sophisticated equipment, and they're monitoring our channels. With buying these new walkie-talkies with inscription will allow us to talk, and nobody else except those individuals with the radios be able to hear what's being said during a drug operation.
So moved. I'm going to pull David's trick. So moved, Sheriff. All in favor?
Thank you. Thank very you. Much.
This would be like the radio that's in Tim's SUV.
But it will be like that, but it'll have special encryption, and it has interoperability with Burlington and the other folks that are on the task force.
Great. Very good. All right, very good. County manager, what you got to talk about today?
Just some very, very good news. We received notification last week that our bond rating has been increased from a AA- to a AA. So especially when we're going out for sale for bonds tomorrow. But let me, I kind of want to read you the first couple of paragraphs. S&P Global Ratings raised its long-term rating on Alamance County's NC General Obligation Bonds to AA from AA-. At the same time, we assigned our AA long-term rating to the county's Series 2016 GO Community College Bonds. The outlook is stable. The rating change reflects the county's consistently strong budgetary performance, which has led to sustained increases in its reserve levels, and the county's adoption of an enhanced formal reserve policy, said S&P Global Ratings credit analyst Daniel Hughes. So I want to congratulate Susan and her staff. I want to thank this board for their direction on policy. We also, with respect to Moody's, Moody's is not as smart as S&P. They kept us at the same. So our ratings with Moody's is AA2. But I am excited as we move forward.
The one helps move us up.
That's right.
In ratings, yes.
But haven't figured out how much it'll save us, but it will definitely save us as far as percentage points moving forward when we sell the bonds tomorrow.
All right.
15 basis points is what Susan's saying, which could result in a lot of money. That's all I have.
Anything else? Commissioners, any comments? I've got a couple thank yous I just want to bring to our board. One was from Mr. Tillman thanking us for our proclamation for the World War II veterans, and that was a very outstanding event. Approximately 1,000 people attended, and almost 2,000 pounds of food was collected for the needy in Alamance County, so that was a great event. And also, Bob and Roger and I went to the JP Junior Police Academy event the other night. A wonderful event, just showing how important it is for law enforcement to talk to our kids as they get older. And Larry Brown put on a wonderful presentation, and I think he might ought to take that act on the road to all the schools in Alamance County. How do you react when a law enforcement officer approaches you? Might save a life or two. That's what I'm thinking. And wonderful event. And I guess, Craig, you guys can find somewhere to put this up.
Yes, sir.
So, and with that, any other comments? All right. Meeting adjourned.
Thank you, sir.
Hey.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.